Well, the question that I was asked to address has to be seen within the context of a few things I want to say. First of all, Institute of Medicine, in a week from now, is coming out with a document which is how to prevent cardiovascular disease worldwide. Actually, I was the chair, and it has been a work of a whole year, almost on a weekly basis in Washington. And I have to really address your question in the concept of there. Now, this committee evolved with the three following principles. First, there is no knowledge of what is going on epidemiologically and economically. Second, there is a lack of responsibility in addressing the issue by everybody who is supposed to. And third, do we have to incentivize people to do the job? This was the principle by which the committee actually evolved. I cannot even say a single word of what the final conclusions are for obvious reasons, but I can certainly say a few things that are observations. Are four issues. One, you all know that this is a global epidemic of cardiovascular disease, but there is an economic burden, but there's a huge confusion here. Confusion number one is that there is a lower incidence of the disease in terms of age adjusted, that his life has been prolonged 6 years in three decades. And actually 4 to 75% is due to treatment, not due to prevention. So is this the disease is decreasing? Here comes the paradox. In fact, the prevalence is increasing. Why? More population get in an older age. We don't allow them to die. And the risk factor profile is still around. So what we are seeing is age-adjusted decrease, but aument the disease is increasing in prevalence. So, and I have to come to the economics of this in a moment. That's the first issue. The second issue is there's a significant gap between the knowledge of what we are talking about and the action at all sectors. The third, and this is actually very troublesome, there is no quantification of information available today by which we could use a gold standard from anywhere and move forward. Everything has been done descriptively, but not quantifying. And I think this is a critical issue which leads to the next point, what to do. And there's an urgent need for intersectorial approaches, government, health system, and so forth. If this is not done, the sense is that things are not going to work. Because at individual basis, many things have been done, but the prevalence of disease is increasing. So there's something wrong with the whole system. And this should be done at the national and subnational levels. And here comes the issue. There are three aspects. One, promoting health. Salt restriction, tobacco regulation, physical activity. This has to be done at a very high level. And although it appears to be stupid, we would decrease 50% of the events by just doing this at the government level like they did in Finland. I think this is very important to really get into this. The second issue is the primary prevention. And this needs regional research and quantifiable data. In other words, the sense is we need demonstration projects. What you cannot do and will not work is to go across the country and set up rules and regulations. It will not work. And I have data from the HRP which will support that. You know, what you can do is to go with SHAPE, look at Texas, wherever you look, see what the data is in 3 or 4 years, and if it works, then you can go to the neighborhood. But to try to make a national guideline is just impossible because you need the backup of lots of institutions which in general they have not been able to do it because of a turf. Each one want to lead it. I will tell you this in a moment. And finally, secondary prevention should also be done at the regional level. And this is all research. So in fact, if you're asking my opinion about SHAPE, it's a research project. You might not like it, but that's what it is. You're trying to figure out what do you get from there and see if your hypothesis is correct. Then nobody knows. You're talking about intimal-medial thickening and look at the discussion. In other words, I think this is very important. So I think SHAPE has a reason to be, but I would be very much against to go into all over the place because it's going to crash. For obvious reasons, because you need data, you need to be convincing, and that's all. So let me now go into the statement number one in the last one, which have some wording. The burden of disease, and this is the paradox. What is basically happening is the incidence of disease is decreasing, that is, life is being prolonged, but the prevalence is increasing, mainly because of treatment, which is, I can tell you the dollars, because there were 7 economists out of the 15 people in the committee. So this is not a joke. It's an economic level of tremendous degree what is happening. In other words, just to tell you that in 10 years in this country, the budget for treatment of cardiovascular disease has multiplied by 3 in 10 years, from $100 billion to $300. So this is the reality. Right.
But when we say this incidence is decreasing, but is it decreasing?
No, no, the mortality, I didn't use the right word. It's the mortality is decreasing by age. In other words, there are less people dying at age 50 today than 3 decades ago. So life has been prolonged 6 years. And people call this mortality incidence, but this is age adjusted. This is correct.
Right.
But you pay a huge price, and that is the treatment is very expensive, and the prevalence is going up. So how do you stop that? And this is really the dilemma that I want to present. Now comes the other issue, is what do you do? So we are really moving into what you call like SHAPE, demonstration projects, and that is, what are hypotheses of work that, if they are correct, may change society where we live? This is really the issue. And now I'm getting out of the government, and I'm not going to go into all of these. These are the 6 we are involved, but I'd like to touch a base on the HRT for a moment, which was your question. You know, this is a mobile unit that almost 7,000 people enter into this unit. There were 18, and this was done in Chicago and in Florida. People were over age of 55, and interestingly, 70% of the population had at least 2 more risk factors in the population of Chicago, which to me was amazing. In other words, we are really dealing with a sick country when you really look in detail. We went to Florida, and it's about 50% of the population over age of 55 has at least 2 risk factors. It's less than the population of Chicago. So you are already dealing with a very high risk population to start with. And then we use different technologies, and this is the 3D ultrasound that I mentioned, calcification of the coronaries, AV differences, and then ultrasound of the abdominal aorta. And then we go into more sophisticated technology. But I'd like to present this because I think it gives the concept. When we look at data of the 3D, which is 1 millimeter or more in focal disease, and you go, for example, women at age 65, it's amazing that almost 50% have bilateral plaques, and actually close to 80% have plaque in one of the carotid arteries, which is what I was saying before. And this is real focal plaque. Now, having said that, then you do positron emission tomography, and you can actually find the whole artery disease. It's not just a focal point, which is the point you're trying to make before. Then you begin to get into the regional disease. The data is beginning to evolve, and I was allowed to present this actually, which is, we are already, what we do with the study is a surrogate endpoint that goes into a 3-year follow-up to see if the burden of disease with all these techniques predicting events. That's the key of the study. And we already had, I think it was about 20 strokes. From these, 16 had bilateral carotid disease. 1 had unilateral, and 3 didn't have disease.
At all, disease meaning according to your 3D, even your 3D...
Just only the 3D.
And your 3D did not find anything in these people who had, 3 people who had a stroke.
Yeah.
Out of...
Okay, but the question is, what is the cause of the stroke? Not necessarily is carotid disease.
Right.
Make sure that we are not...
Right.
So, but the point is, there's a lot of predictability though. You cannot use a statistic with these numbers, but this is really happening. And then when you go into the coronary artery, this has to be tabulated, but the point is, there is already a trend showing that when you have bilateral disease, the score of calcification is much higher. So, and we could go into the legs and so forth. I want to conclude, this is actually a new machine that we have, which is PET MR, and then we'll have CT2, all in a single machine, but this is all research. The point I'm trying to make is, and I think Erling is in agreement with, this is a diffuse disease, absolutely diffuse. And the question is, where you capture it first, you can already tell what Framingham just showed, that at 10 years, 25% of people with two risk factors may have a stroke. But if you follow for 30 years, 75% have it. So I think we have to look at the risk factors quite differently, and that is, if you give your life 30 years span, is much of a problem if you have risk factors that you just stay on the 10-year deal, which has been always a debate. 75% will not happen to me. This is a huge issue, and the imaging supports that.
It will be even more if you shorten the time period. If you're looking at the definition, what we're interested, for example, in the vulnerable patient discussion, then you're looking at changing behavior in the next 2-3 years or 5 years. In that time period, the risk factor will become even less and less predictive because, as you said, their lifetime predictive value is good. But in the short term, and we should know that people really don't change behavior, I mean, psychologically, based on lifetime. It is something that you tell them if something is going to happen.
I'm not sure. Let me tell you preliminary data here. Okay, these scans were shown to about 500 patients. Your arteries are plugged up. Okay, let me tell you, we don't have this now, but we just have been discussing. And the problem is a drama in the first month. After a month, this is a matter of the doctors and of the scientists who's over. And then, unless the doctor becomes obsessive, this goes away. And this explains the Eurospire data in Europe, where patients with myocardial infarction, only 50% are using the 3 drugs they are supposed to use after the infarct in a year of follow-up. So we are in a society in which we constantly reject the concept that we feel well, that we are in trouble. Therefore, you can screen anybody you want, but the problem you still face is how, unless you have a system that is able to incentivize people and to do something, you end up halfway. And this is actually one of the things that we are beginning to find out, very deceptive, but really comes from many other studies which directly and indirectly show the same thing, that we tend to reject the situation we feel
well. I think you're referring to the same thing. After a year, they forgot. Their memory span is, you know, 6 months. And so if we
Is after a month.
Is that after a month? So we have a major issue here with the compliance.
That's not true. There are several coronary calcium studies which show increased compliance, increased prescription of statins and aspirin, and duration of compliance with therapy after seeing the calcium.
Yeah, maybe this is different. Here comes the issue, I can tell you, who you select for the calcification, and you start with a select with a population, many of them are obsessive. This is not. This is really going to an overall population of humana in which there is no such a thing of selectivity. And I think this is a critical issue. We all have our patients who come to us and they want every test being done. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm really talking is, actually, we did the demographics of the Chicago area, and we really got the people, demographically speaking, were not different than the general population, economically speaking. So it's the way you enter the patient into these studies, you might have what you say, you might not. My point of view, after reviewing all of this, is actually rather pessimistic in terms of how the society reacts to all of this. This is all that I can tell you.
A general comment. I think we would agree that there are all these problems and you're projecting a 10-year interval in which to answer them, right? Yeah. But we have a problem right now, and we have tools like coronary calcium and IMT, which can identify high-risk patients. So
I go along with you. This is why we are doing this, but I want to point out it's a demonstration project. It's a research project. It's not you're going to convince the United States population that you have to go all over the country doing IMT because it's not going to happen.
Well, on the other side, we have USPTF Task Force, which sits here and refer to it, you know, their latest publication was 2004 or 5, and they're defining our national healthcare. I mean, this is unbelievable.
Well, I agree with you, and we have to push it.
Yeah,
which is
we have
why
to
I'm sitting
push
here,
it. Yeah,
but
we have
I
to.
Want to be very realistic, and that is we need to know the parameters we are dealing with, because otherwise, you can be realistic into one.
We have to create the evidence. You're the first to create this with HRP trial. And if HRP comes out in a year or 2 years with strong evidence, then there would be a big push.
You need to create the science.
And we're trying to do the same thing instead of Texas, putting monitoring tool after 2 years of implementation of this bill. What will happen?
This is what is lacking.
That's what we're going to do.
Absolutely.
No, that's exactly what we're trying to do in the state of Texas, to put monitoring tool both at the economical level as well as the number of people, what happened after that, so we can show the national level.